Good afternoon. On behalf of the faculty, staff, and trustees of the college, I extend a warm welcome to you, the class of 2019, and to your parents, families, and friends who have joined us for our baccalaureate ceremony. Baccalaureate is believed to have originated at the University of Oxford in 1432, where each degree candidate would deliver a sermon in Latin. Here in America, the first baccalaureate ceremony was held at Princeton University in 1760, which was then known as the College of New Jersey. Today, baccalaureate is where we focus on your personal growth and achievements in and outside of the classroom. Class of 2019, you have shown us that you are committed to being global citizens, as demonstrated by you spending a semester or a year abroad in record numbers. You have demonstrated your culminating scholarship, research, and critical thinking skills at the annual thesis conference. You have excelled on the performing arts stage, on the athletic field, and in scholastic competitions. You are committed to community service and creating an equitable and inclusive environment. You are entrepreneurs with a desire to make this world a better place. You are unique individuals that make up the most talented graduating class we have ever seen. Congratulations to you all, and it is now my pleasure to introduce Reverend Gail Cantor.
Thank you. Baccalaureate is an opportunity before your actual graduation ceremony to reflect on your time here at Endicott College and to align the spirit of graduating from college with the practical aspects of graduating from college. When what you're doing in the circumstances of life aligns with the spiritual, with meaningful values, there's a condition of real accomplishment and deep fulfillment. Success and inspiration come together and life is lit up. Creator of life, we invoke your presence here today to bless this baccalaureate ceremony. Bless these graduating seniors with the room to reflect on their college experience and convert that reflection into powerful inspiration that they can actualize as they start their journey of contribution and accomplishment. Amen.
You may be seated. I would like to extend a welcome to the faculty, graduating seniors, and their families and friends at this baccalaureate service in recognition of the class of 2019. By participating in this ceremony, you are joining a tradition that is celebrated at colleges across the country as a farewell address, a ceremony recognizing the successful completion of an academic career. Together with commencement, the baccalaureate is one of the most important events in the academic life of this community. In contrast to the excitement of commencement, the baccalaureate provides us with a more reflective setting in which to recognize the accomplishments of our graduates as they prepare to face the future. And the ceremony offers you, our graduates, an opportunity to reflect on the challenges, the past experiences, and the individuals, faculty, friends, and family members who have enriched your lives and have contributed to the realization of your academic goals during your 4 years at Endicott College. I am sure that I speak for the faculty when I say that our greatest hope is that we have been successful in our roles as educators and as mentors. Successful not just in sharing our knowledge and expertise with you, but more importantly, in giving you the intellectual tools to help you navigate and bring clarity to the issues and challenges you'll encounter in your professional and personal lives. Our hope, too, is that we have exposed you to ideas and intellectual challenges that have piqued your curiosity, touched your imagination, and helped shape your dreams. As you enter and begin to move through perhaps the most exciting crossroads of your lives, the best advice that I can give you is to stay focused on your dreams and allow them to shape the goals that you set for yourselves. Class of 2019, best wishes to each one of you as you prepare to graduate. And now I would like to introduce, thank you. I would like to introduce Michael Amato to share some reflections of his time at Endicott. Michael majored in business with a minor in English and was a member of the Endicott Scholars Program. He will be attending law school at Wake Forest University next fall. Please welcome Mike Amato.
Sorry, guys. It wouldn't be me if I weren't awkward to start my presentation today. My first profound memory at Endicott took place in the third week of my freshman year. Griffin Powers and Nick Burgess, whom I'd only known for about 7 days at the time, knocked on my door. Griffin did the talking. He looked at me and said, in this order, I have very limited piloting experience, but I've been watching a lot of videos on YouTube, and I think I can go up in the air today and wing it. I'm sure some of you are ahead of me already. But don't worry, I did the responsible thing. I said yes, didn't tell my parents, and proceeded to sign a waiver that stated if the plane were to suddenly crash, my parents couldn't sue the airport. So yeah, college was off to a pretty good start. That flight gave me some life experiences I'll never forget. I got to take some fierce selfies, try out some exotic filters on Instagram, and speak in code pretending to be the captain of the aircraft. That is, until the actual captain told me to stop. But seriously, I'll never forget that night. I know I can't ethically suggest that you make a spontaneous choice to go flying, but what I can do is tell you that the Beverly Flight Center is a great place to start. Or better yet, find your own way to challenge yourself. I promise it'll be worth it. At Endicott, you'll often hear about something called the Endicott Experience. In my opinion, there are two Endicott experiences. The first is individual. Each student and graduate, like myself, will tell you their own version. However, there is also the second type, and that's the collective experience. Both types will be the focus of my time here today. My Endicott career began where all fairy tales do, at a gymnasium convocation surrounded by a bunch of sweaty teenagers and their parents. When Dr. Rossi Lee asked me if I could speak today, I reflected upon how I've changed throughout the years. I thought of my freshman year self, clean-shaven, shy, awkward, and terrible at doing my laundry, and I look at myself today. Bearded, outgoing, but still awkward and still terrible at doing my laundry. All of us in attendance today have changed in some ways. We're more polished professionally, we have more diverse skill sets, and we've had many opportunities to explore and grow. Long after my time at Endicott is complete, which I'm now just realizing is tomorrow, the Endicott experience memories will remain fresh. I'll never forget the nights my roommates and I would stay awake until 7 a.m. so we could go see the sunrise at Peace Rock. I'll never forget Monday night wrestling tournaments in Pod D. Keeping that thought going, I'll certainly never forget, though trust me, I've tried, my roommate Lou icing himself with a bag of frozen ravioli after sealing a comeback win. These are all part of my individual experience here at Endicott. Each of you have your own experience that I hope you reflect on and celebrate as we move throughout the graduation weekend. As a class, we've shared some incredible moments. For example, we've spent numerous nights in the gorgeous Misselwood tent, both at the senior toast and countdown to commencement. Speaking recently, I'll never forget senior week, and that's as specific as I'll get on that subject. On a serious note, we've rallied together for great causes, such as Relay for Life runs and 9/11 moments of silence around the lake. Regardless of the types of memories we've shared throughout the years, a couple of things remain consistent. We've lived moments and created relationships that will outlast our time at college. For as much time as we've spent enjoying, we've also spent some time enduring. On May 12, 2018, we lost our fearless and growth-minded leader, Dr. Richard Wiley. Dr. Wiley is the reason why many of us are graduating here tomorrow. Dr. Wiley was the stand-up type of gentleman who remembered each of us by name after meeting us only once. He had the ability to not only sympathize with students, but empathize with us as well. Each day, he'd make several trips down to the main campus from College Hall. I'll forever have an appreciation for the time he asked me if I wanted to ride across campus in his custom golf cart, as he could see I was running late to class as usual. I'll also never forget the nights Dr. Wiley would invite us to his home for a barbecue, during finals especially, when we were all in dire need of a late night snack. Somewhere up in heaven, I know that Dr. Wiley is proud of all the graduates who will accept their diplomas tomorrow. It cannot be stated enough the tremendous debt we owe Doc for creating such a welcoming, collaborative, and truly unique community. This is part of our collective goal experience, and we can remember him best by making the most of our education and helping those around us. None of us got to this weekend without the help of others. I'd like to use some time to thank members of the Endicott community for helping me transform throughout the last 4 years. I'll start off with my former baseball coach, Brian Haley. Coach Haley instilled in me a mental toughness that's helped me as much off the field as it has on the field. He also taught me to be comfortable being uncomfortable and stay humble in both victory and defeat. I'd also like to thank Dean Sarah Quay and Dr. Amy D'Amico. These esteemed professors sparked in me a relentless passion to inquire, challenge myself, and pursue academic interests. In this case, it meant motivating me to become a future lawyer. And finally, I'd like to thank some professional advisors and what I like to call my at-school mothers, Kathy Butler and Aileen Torrance. These two women taught me not only how to write a cover letter, but more importantly, how to best position myself in an ever-changing business environment. I'd also be remiss if I didn't apologize to some people I've wronged throughout the years. To the girls in Pod B who lived below me last year, you know it's coming. I apologize for bouncing a basketball at 1 a.m. several times. In my defense, I had just recently seen High School Musical and really thought I could both dribble and sing like Zac Efron. I'd also like to apologize to the students who witnessed me playing Club Penguin in the library during finals week of the fall 2016 semester. Stress can do crazy things to a college student's mind. And finally, I'd like to apologize to anybody who has parked near me over the last 4 years. I guess that's why I'm leaving here with a Bachelor's of Science and not a Bachelor's of Parallel Parking. These are some of my thank yous and apologies, and I know you all have your own as well. I hope you take the time to thank the people who made a difference during your years at Endicott College. So, my fellow goals, it's been both an honor and a privilege to don the Endicott blue and Kelly green with you over the last 4 years. Although I get choked up knowing that our time here is over, you've made these 4 years the best years of my young life. It is now my pleasure to introduce the president of the Alumni Council, Elisa DeGaspe-Beaubien. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I would like to introduce our baccalaureate speaker, Dr. Luke Reynolds. Dr. Luke Reynolds was a public school English teacher at the middle and secondary level for many years before coming to Endicott College to join the faculty in the education department. His passion is to link literature and life, to join theory and practice, and to connect contemplation with action. He received his Master of Arts in Creative Writing from Northern Arizona University and earned his PhD in Education from Boston College. Among his books for children, adolescents, and teachers are A Call to Creativity, Writing, Reading, and Inspiring Students in an Age of Standardization, Surviving Middle School, Fantastic Failures, True Stories of People Who Changed the World by Falling Down First, If A Daddy's Love Song, The Gum-Mazing Gum Series, Bedtime Blast-Off, and The Looney Experiment. Luke and his wife, Jennifer, are the parents to three young boys, Tyler, Benjamin, and Joshua. A core principle by which Luke aims to live his life is from the ancient philosopher Philo. Be kind, for everyone you meet is engaged in a battle. And with that, I would like to provide your award, Dr. Reynolds.
Thank you so much for the honor of speaking to you here today. Interim President Barnes, Vice President Rossi Lee, Reverend Cantor, Alumni Association President DeGaspe-Beaubien, Speaker Amato, Senior Class President Dillon, alumni, faculty, staff, and graduating gulls of the class of 2019. I'm so proud of every one of you. You have worked hard And we celebrate this beautiful moment when your accomplishments are so tangible and pronounced. Today, I want to share two challenges with you. But be warned, they aren't easy. One deals with how you approach the world. The other deals with how you approach yourself. First, see others for who they really are. Early on in my career, when I was teaching seventh grade English, I had a student named Mike who failed almost every assessment I gave. On vocab quizzes, he handed back blank paper cartoon drawings. On essays, he wrote a few sentences, often consisting of the lines, "Mr. Reynolds, here are a few sentences." You just read them right there. Those were the sentences, the end. Mike was late to class and asked to use the bathroom all the time. In team meetings with other teachers about Mike, the adults in the room consistently claimed that Mike just didn't care. He had no work ethic. He never tried. He didn't have that all-consuming educational buzzword, grit. Mike's average in my English class was a 42% by the spring of that seventh grade year. Then we started poetry. We tried our hands and hearts at all kinds and forms of poems, and Mike did almost none of them. And then we got to iambic pentameter, 10 beautiful syllables per line, each short, coupled with its best friend, long. In the back corner of the class, Mike put his head down and wrote, and wrote, and wrote. I'd never seen him work with such focus and intensity. When I collected the poems, I sat at my desk in the corner of my classroom, shuffled through the papers to find Mike's, and read. I wept. His iambs told of abuse, of feeling lost, of feeling unloved, of feeling unseen. To this day, it is the single most beautiful and profoundly moving poem I have ever read. And it showed me that Mike's story was far bigger than a 42%, far more complex than a missed assignment, and far more meaningful than a projection of indifference. See others for who they really are, not according to what our preconceptions would suggest. The people we meet come complete with stories that sprawl below the surface, with heartaches and hopes that we will never see if we consent to know them only superficially. Dig deeper. Ask more questions. Wonder about what happened to that person before and what might be coming their way in the future. See other people for who they really are. The second challenge I want to give you deals with how you approach yourself. This isn't the end of your story. After my wife Jennifer and I had our first son, we made the choice to uproot ourselves and him and move to England. I left the PhD program that I was in at Boston College, and I gave my notice regarding my seventh grade teaching position. We were after an adventure, something that would shake us out of our comfort zone, push us to live close to the bone. Little did we know how close to the bone we'd get. In England, Jennifer was working on her PhD and doing some teaching. I was a stay-at-home dad to our son, Tyler, who was two. I figured that after teaching hundreds of middle schoolers, 1 2-year-old would be easy. No. I gained a deep and profound respect for anyone who stays home with their kids. My conversation with my 2-year-old went something like this. "Daddy, we go outside?" "Yeah, let's go outside, buddy." We would get on coats and rain boots because it rained every single day in England. And we'd approach the door to go outside. That's when my son would stop. "Daddy, we know go outside. We play inside. You Batman. Daddy Batman. Well, let's go outside. We're all ready, right? Here we go. Hooray for outside. Daddy, we know go outside. We stay inside. Daddy Batman, hooray. Well, Daddy be Batman inside later. We go outside now. Hooray. Daddy Batman inside now. Daddy Batman inside later. Daddy Batman inside now. Daddy Batman inside later. Daddy inside, outside, inside." A few moments would pass, and then my sweet, lovely son would add, as if the entire exchange was a figment of my imagination, "Daddy, we go outside now?" Our 3 years in England taught us a lot, but I learned most from my time as a 32-year-old newspaper delivery boy. Money had been tight, and even though we resigned ourselves to instant coffee, no car, no TV, and pasta for many, many meals, we still struggled to make rent. I had seen a sign in the shop across from our rental that said, "Boys and girls needed for newspaper routes, mornings." I put my name in, thinking we could make a few pounds, and it was something I could do early in the morning, before our son awoke. I had, after all, been a pretty decent paper boy when I was 12. The only difference would be that this time I'd put the money towards rent instead of Laffy Taffy and Fifth Avenue chocolate bars. Well, I got the job. The corner store gave me a bright fluorescent bag emblazoned with the words, "The Guardian," on the side, which I thought was incredibly because even though The Guardian is a British newspaper, I secretly like to imagine that it was my superhero name. Luke Reynolds is The Guardian. I woke from my first day on the job early, ate a filling breakfast of pasta and instant coffee, sported my fluorescent bag, collected my 27 newspapers, hopped on my bike, and I was off. The wind in my two-day-old stay-at-home dad beard, here I come, world. I was optimistic, thinking this would be a fun little gig to help make ends meet. And then I got to my first crosswalk. Beside me was a girl of maybe 12 or 13 with her own fluorescent bag. Another guardian like me. As we waited for the signal to cross, I struck up a conversation. Pretty fun, huh? Great morning, newspapers to deliver, great stuff, right? A look of utter embarrassment on my behalf shot back. She then glanced away, stifled a laugh, and shook her head. And that was all it took. My pride and optimism sank to shame and embarrassment. Those voices completely took over. Wait a minute, Luke. She's right. Think about it, man. You're 32 years old. 32. You have a wife and a young son. You're struggling to pay rent, and this is what you come up with? Seriously? This is your grand plan? I proceeded to do the route that morning, albeit with much less spunk. Time passed. The few pounds we made from the route did, in fact, help, if only to buy instant coffee and the pasta. But as I woke every morning to do the 27 newspapers, brandishing my Guardian fluorescent bag, I started to see signs of hope everywhere, everywhere me. There was one house at the end of a cul-de-sac where an old woman lived who was always rocking in her chair by the window every morning when I delivered the paper. Most mornings, she just stared at me as I dropped the paper off by her door. But on one particularly rough morning for me, she leaned forward in her rocking chair, waited till I looked right at her, and then forcefully stuck out her right arm and gave me a big thumbs up. A supremely non-British thing to do. I was so surprised that I had to Google thumbs up in England just to make sure she wasn't secretly cursing me out. She wasn't. It was all good. And she continued to give me encouraging signals through her window every morning when I dropped off the newspaper. Another morning, I was dropping off a paper on a busy corner lot and found a duck limping across the grass. The duck looked pretty spent, and his leg was in bad shape. I told the duck, "I know how you feel, man. I'm with you, duck. We're both just kind of limping along, trying to make ends meet. It's hard out here, duck. You know, I mean, it's..." But then the duck just kind of rose up as a rocket ship, high and strong to soar away, as if to say, "Don't give me your pity." I had pegged him as on his way out, but he had a lot of fight left yet. And the most beautiful morning as a paperboy had started as the worst. It was sleeting. It was freezing. The ground was covered in ice and slush, and I'd quickly fallen off my bike as soon as I began the route that morning. I carried the bike back home, chucked it by the side of the house, and grumpily began marching the route, slush seeping into my boots. 27 newspapers, 32 years old, stupid newspaper route. What am I doing with my life? Such were the thoughts that accompanied me that morning. It was the breaking point. I had done the route for a while. No writing projects had been published to help make ends meet. And I had felt as though this was the end of my story. Failure. I was in the middle of the route, soaked and cold and defeated, when I heard a voice shouting from far behind me. "Luke! Luke!" And then another voice, a smaller one. "Daddy!" Turning, I saw my wife and my son. They were walking, no, running toward me. I waited, tears already welling up in my eyes. When they reached me, my wife looked me straight in the eye and said, "We'll do the paper route together today." And we did. They turned my moment of greatest shame into a seed of hope, a memory of love, and a chance for renewal. What each of these small moments of encouragement said to me was one specific thing. This isn't the end of your story. Some of you have experienced the darkness and the despair already. It may have been a death in the family, a broken relationship, a terrible grade, some ambiguous sense of shame over a mistake
or a missed chance, or as Langston Hughes would say, a dream deferred. This year, I have sat with some of you in my office as we worked through these hard moments. And I do have one sobering truth to tell you. You will encounter darkness again, but this is exactly when you reach out. At those moments when all seems lost, you must remember that you are not alone. Others among us have felt the same fear, the same confusion, the same anxiety, the same angst and shame and struggle. So you reach out, you email me, you email or call or connect with one another, with professors who have championed you, administrators who have believed in you, staff who have bolstered you, family and friends who have walked beside you. And when you do reach out to those of us who have had the great honor to accompany you as part of your story here at, we will be ready. We will be ready to remain always in your corner, whether you reach out tomorrow or 10 years from now. And the words we'll say back to you are simply these: this is not the end of your story. Hope will reemerge. Beautiful opportunities await you. It is going to be okay. Because we live in a world of pain and sadness and hardships, yes, but we also live in a world where broken birds fly, old English ladies give you the thumbs up, and those who truly love you meet you in the place of your shame and failure and tell you with strong hearts and fierce eyes, this is not the end of your story. And I, for one, wait with downright giddy enthusiasm to see what your next page, your next chapter brings. Go write it. Go live it. Thank you.
Thank you to the Endicott Singers. Good afternoon. Welcome guests, faculty, staff, family, friends, and most importantly, the class of 2019. Today we gather on the same field that in just 24 short hours we will graduate on. I think I can speak for many as though it feels that just yesterday we were moving into our freshman year housing assignment, unpacking cars filled with everything we absolutely needed for college. These 4 years have flown by, and I feel so grateful that I was surrounded by all of you through it all. Before I begin my speech, there are a few people I'd like to thank. First and foremost, I'd like to thank every single faculty and staff member who's played a role in my college career, every single RA, RD, club advisor, professor, boss, has helped me get to where I am today. I'd also like to take a moment to thank my fellow class officers, Gabrielle Eaton, Janelle Lee May, Lauren Pryor, and our honorary officer, Shiv. You got between stuffing over 500 senior sippies to planning each event, this year, and especially this week, would not have been possible without your continued hard work. You're all going to be incredible nurses. I also have to give a quick shout out to my people from spring break, Breezes Forever, as well as my Standish homies, G2, and my good friend, Dylan Sieber. You're all the most amazing friends I've ever had. I also have to give a quick thank you to my family, specifically my parents. You've supported me through every idea I've ever had, no matter how ridiculous they got, and you've always been in my corner. You two are a true testament to strength and perseverance, and I'm so proud to call you my parents. Thank you. As a class, we've experienced so much together. We've seen Frady's, the new AC, and the new LSB get built, none of which we got to use. We watched one Gullies come and go, then gave the new Gullies quite the welcome. We made the townhouses great again. We won so many championships during our time. New clubs were formed, and this year there were plenty of registered social gatherings. Our grade time and time again showed up, and each time we exceeded everyone's expectations, especially at Champagne Toast. While our grade has done some incredible things during our time here, we are no stranger to loss. During the fall of our junior year, we lost a dear friend and classmate. While I did not know Tim personally, his good friends have stated just how kind and positive he was, and our senior class gift is a physical reminder on this campus that is dedicated in his memory. When I found out I had to speak today, first off, I freaked out, because as you saw at Champagne Toast, public speaking isn't my thing. But secondly, I was told to tell you all to go out and do something. 4 years, a whole lot of money, sleepless nights, and hard work later, what one single thing do you tell a group of people to go do? And then it hit me. Class of 2019, while you're all going to do some incredible stuff during your lifetimes after leaving this nest, please remember to be kind. It's a simple message, but in the hustle of our own lives, remember to take a deep breath and be kind to those around you. The kindness you show another person can change the course of a day, a week, a month, a year. Our world is polarized and divided right now in every facet of life. No matter what political party you identify with, how old you are, what your major is, or how much is in your bank account, you have the ability to show kindness to other people. Kindness is a ripple effect, and often simple acts that go unnoticed mean the world to others. Heading into my sophomore year of college here, I lost a dear friend of mine. This loss had me call into question my own worth and everything else you can imagine. Some days getting out of bed was an accomplishment, but it was on those days that the kindness of those around me kept me fighting for just one more. One day a friend brought me a Gatorade as I laid in bed for the third day in a row, unbeknown to them. Another day a stranger paid for my coffee in line after I had cried in my car for hours. Another, a classmate complimented me on a sweater I was wearing when I had questioned whether I could even gather up the strength to get out of bed for class. These were minuscule moments that those around me probably did not realize I would remember, let alone speak about at baccalaureate 2 years later. These small moments of kindness gave me a small glimmer of light in a time of my life that was so very dark. Leo Bushgali once said, "Too often we underestimate the power of a touch, a smile, a kind word, a listening ear, an honest compliment, or the smallest act of caring, all of which have the power to turn a life around. There is no job title, no relationship status, no paycheck, and no office that has more power than that of being kind. We are in a world right now that is constantly labeling and categorizing everyone. We often prefer to point out what makes us different, not what we have in common. Everyone sitting here right now enjoys when others show them kindness. The warmth of hearing a loved one say they love you back. The hug of a good friend after a long day. When a stranger buys your coffee, when a classmate compliments your outfit, or when a friend brings you a Gatorade in bed. While yes, there's much darkness in this world we live in, there's war, there's death, there's violence, there's disappointment. Despite all of this, not in spite of it, there's still so much light. And that's where my challenge comes to all of you. After spending 4 years with me, I'm sure most of you expected me to get up on this stage and say to go out there and fight for what you believe in and do everything with passion, which I still stand by. Rather, today I wanted to take the time to remind you that you have the power, in the face of great adversity or just your morning commute, which on 128 is pretty much the same thing, to be kind to those around you. We all may not agree on the same political candidates or have grown up in the same neighborhoods or have the same majors, but we can all agree that this world needs a little more kindness in it. Tomorrow you'll be adults and you'll have to leave the safety of this nest. Rather, it's not the degrees you hold, how you look on the outside, what designer you wear, or the car you drive that shows your worth, but rather the character you have on the inside that decides it. Nobody's perfect, and I'm far from it, but I hope that if I've learned nothing else from this great institution, that I learned how incredibly important and impactful it can be to show people basic human kindness. Class of 2019, now that I've rambled on for some time, I'll leave you with this. As many of you know, I talk a lot. My mom can especially attest to this since I called her at least 4 times every day since moving. Even someone as chatty as me is left truly speechless standing up in front of all of you. You have all impacted me in ways that thank you will never be enough to cover. Whether we were friends or this is the first time you've seen me, know that you have changed me in ways I could never imagine. I think back to good old Winnie the Pooh in this moment when he said, "Goodbye? Oh no, can't we please go back to page one and start all over again? I wish nothing more that we could go back to page one and do this all over again. But since we cannot, I'm so incredibly excited to see what the next chapter holds for all of you. Now, class of 2019, please stand for the benediction.
May the divine presence of creation be with you always. And from the lyrics of a song by Leanne Womack, I hope you never lose your sense of wonder. You get your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger. May you never take one simple breath for granted. God forbid love ever leaves you empty-handed. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. I hope you never fear those mountains in the distance, never settle for the path of least resistance. Living might mean taking chances, but they're worth taking. Loving might be a mistake, but it's worth making. Don't let some hell-bent heart leave you bitter. When you come close to selling out, reconsider. Give the heavens above more than just a passing glance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. Amen. Please join us for the award ceremony, which will begin shortly. Thank you.